sidewalks that are there will remain. The curb cuts that are there will also remain. Item 2J, which I just went over, there's no change there. Item 2K, location and design of existing and proposed stormwater systems. There's no change from the existing. Also, all of the city utilities are in place, or town utilities are in place. Garbage is currently stored in a rear of the property shed and is removed on a weekly basis by a private carrier. Item 2L, landscaping and buffering plan showing what will remain and what will be planted. Essentially, we have shown an addition of some planting directly around the building. We've indicated some planting in a grass strip, which is in agreement with the neighbors. And it will specifically address the design and issues of buffering under item 3. Let me get to that. Okay. And if there's any question on the plant materials, we can talk about that later. The existing lighting, this is item M, which is details with the lighting and the location. We're essentially going to leave the existing lighting, which is your street town lighting that is already in place, and that's shown on the existing plan. And also on our drawing A1.1, there is some lighting on the front elevation, and there will be a entry light shown there. Anybody see that? Mm-hmm. Item 2N is the location on the signage, and there is a sign that is currently located in this position there. It is a sign which is lit, and it plans to remain lit from dusk to dawn, as well as the one on the building. That also will remain lit. Moving on to your item 3, what I have a handout for you.
Madam Chairman?
Yeah.
Perhaps if the board wanted, we could deal with the completeness items first, which I believe have been dealt with or almost dealt with, and then go on to the substantive. That's just a suggestion I would have.
So I think we could probably dispense with going through all these items.
Right.
And do it that way.
But we may want to find
good
out.
Suggestion.
You may want to see what the handout is first.
Yeah.
Does it relate to the substantive?
Yeah, I think it does. Okay. This is traffic analysis by Bill Bragg.
Okay, then we may.
You want to do something else
yeah.
first?
Okay.
Maybe just to lend some order, because I think we might tend to blur. If you want, I can go through my checklist
and
all the
Steve.
Rest. And then we can go in substantive. I just want to let the board know there's a memo that I prepared very recently. You got it tonight. The applicant hasn't seen it, but it deals with some of the substantive issues. In terms of completeness, I think the issues that are outstanding are pretty minor, as were alluded to. Topography, I think we know what it is. It's almost, but again, if the board doesn't have a concern, you can put a check there under 9. Under the checklist, 12A, existing and proposed stormwater systems, again, I don't think that's a big issue, but I leave that to the board. Landscape and buffering plan, again, minor, but in terms of the plantings, I think 2 points. One is that from the plan that I have, they're only proposing new plantings on the side, on the southerly side of the building, not in front. And what's missing there in terms of completeness would be the dimensions of the plants at the time of planting, and secondly, when they actually would be planted. Final item that's missing is evidence of right title interest. We just want to ensure that Mr. Balfour does indeed own the property. It's something I discussed with Bruce Butler, who is not related to me, and he said he'd be bringing that this evening. So there are some items that are missing, but I think they're relatively minor. One other point in respect to the presentation up to this point is it was stated that the parking, there's going to be no change in on-site parking. That's not quite true in that the parking to the south, or looking at site plan to the right, actually gets used by up to three cars, if not even more. There's an issue in terms of the existing pavement that extends way beyond the area that the applicant owns. The applicant stated that, not here, but elsewhere, that he's going to pretty much try and keep the parking confined to his site. So I think that needs to be clarified. And then the substantive issue is, well, how is he going to do
more than trying to confine the parking to your site?
Pardon?
Well,
no, the sidewalk actually is a small area. Then there's a lot of paved area that goes between what's owned. If you look in the site plan, that whole area.
This is all DOT property.
Right. So it's not owned by the applicant, but it's used by the applicant. And so there's a question in terms of for parking. And there's a question in terms of if that should continue or not. So I just wanted to clarify that point as well.
I think as long as I said, would you mind if I have a question, and I think this is an opportunity to do something about it. I've always wondered where the fine line between the property, the road, and the sidewalk is, and I know you don't control, Mr. Balfour doesn't control where people park, and it seems to me that cars are in different angles and configurations depending on who drives up where. And in fact, sometimes I think it's almost blocking if you're coming around the corner, if you're riding a bike or something like that. And I wonder whether you have given some thought to, along with what you're going to do here, establishing the boundaries in a clear way so that we know that there's a way around, that there's a continuation of the sidewalk, whether it's lines for parking or whether it's some sort of planters or whatever else, so that it's absolutely clear where people are supposed to go and where they're not supposed to go. And I didn't see any of that on the plan. Maybe I'm saying the same thing, Steve, but it might be our one shot to clear that up.
Yeah. That was good reinforcement. Steve, perhaps you could allude to the memo.
It's going to jump on presentation, maybe we should get some of the issues out.
Mm-hmm.
So the memo that everybody should have this evening raises four major issues that came up during the review. And that's something that the applicant's representatives, one of the architects I've spent had a couple lengthy meetings with, so these shouldn't be new. One is, as was mentioned, the fact that although the site plan addition is relatively small, this is a very visible part of the town, the center of the town, and the site itself, board needs to look beyond just the physical addition, but to looking at the site as it is and how that site meets the current site plan review standards. So in terms of landscaping and buffering, I mentioned the fact that the plantings are relatively minimal. There's some grassing and there's some planting to the side of the building, nothing to the front. And as part of that, I mentioned the point that Dan dealt with in terms of a need, perhaps in terms of planting or otherwise, to kind of create some sort of separation, visual separation, and as well as maybe increasing the aesthetics of the site between the existing sidewalk, which is asphalt, in the parking area, which is also asphalt, and you have to really be standing right there looking, and you can see that there's a slight coloration difference between the shades of gray or black and the asphalt, and perhaps something more could be done. In terms of the parking space delineation, again, it deals with the fact that we need to somehow come up with a workable and realistic way of limiting parking to that one space over to the right, if then that indeed is what the applicant's proposing to do. And they don't do that yet. I think it wouldn't take all that much, and perhaps the applicant's architects have come up with an idea. Snow removal, it turns out, is an issue. Came up at the department head meeting on this item, and it appears as though in past years, minor issue, but as with a lot of minor issues, and probably tonight's storm is alludes us to the fact that, especially when it comes to snow removal, a lot of minor issues quickly become major. The fact is that it appears, though, when the lot is being cleared of snow, there's some intrusion, some to the private lane in the rear, but more importantly for the board, there's some intrusion onto the public sidewalks, which then need to be, more often than not, I guess, cleared by the town staff. I think not by the Public Works Department. So I think, in terms of how the snow gets removed, it is a small area, the parking lot's small, it's very tight. I think we need to see if the applicant's going to be using a shovel in essence, to plow it away and where that's going to be stored, or if he's going to be using a scoop, you know, or if he needs to use a scoop to, you know, take the snow, put it in a truck, move it out of there. We're getting into the real nitty-gritty. the final issue, and I'll stop, is the issue of the sign. The sign currently is on the public, appears to be within the public right-of-way, I believe. Yeah. It needs to be pulled back so that it's onto the applicant's property, and that's something that would be done sooner or later by the town anyway. This is an opportune time to raise the issue and have it dealt with. So those are the major points that I flagged. Town staff flag, nice one. Get them on the table, and they're there, and we can deal with it.
Thank you, Steve. Any questions or comments?
First comment, I would, completeness of the application, I do have for
the board that they transfer the
thank you. Well, we would have to take the time to look at this.
I'm sorry, beg your pardon?
All submissions had to have been made, you know, quite some time ago. I haven't recognized you, sir. If you want to speak, please raise your hand. And it's something important. But go ahead, Mr. Solomon.
Okay. Would the board like to finish the completeness of an application first or jump into the substantive issues?
Let's do completeness. Okay. Any comments or questions on completeness?
Again, I think the two points on the checklist are topography and stormwater systems. I didn't see a big issue with it. The town engineer didn't. So unless the planning board has an issue, we can move on to other two. And other two are minor. I think this I think this meets the requirement. I mean, this shows pretty clearly. We should probably give it to Judith. Have it since it's a deed. But it pretty much shows that, you know, as we all suspected and pretty much knew, that Mr. Balfour does own the property. And then the issue is going to be in terms of getting the size of the plantings, when those are going to be done. In terms of completeness, that's something you could, again, probably ask to be done as part of the revised site plan.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments or questions? Do I hear a motion?
I didn't prepare a suggestion motion.
I make a motion that we accept this application as complete.
Second.
Any discussion?
Madam Chairman, just before we do that, what is, for the applicant, what is the procedure for a site plan as opposed to a subdivision?
That's under section 19-2-9. We definitely go to a site walk.
Mm-hmm.
A completeness vote isn't required. It's starting to become something that gets done. Not necessary, but trying to mimic subdivision.
I guess, is my point. A completeness vote is something that we do in a subdivision process before
right.
we can initiate the review.
That's right.
It's not something that's in our ordinance for site plan review. But what is the process that we go through at this point? We set a public hearing on an application.
Public mm-hmm. hearing is optional.
Do we do a site walk
definitely,
on the site plan?
Definitely okay. A site walk would be next.
And right. issues of where we feel additional data may be required yep. or concerns about the site plan even expressed at this point?
Sure. I think we could do that now. Take a few more minutes.
You do have a motion for
A motion, that's right.
Completeness.
And I'm just any other discussion? Yeah.
That's what we're discussing. And I'm just wondering, do we do that?
Any other discussion on the completeness issue? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Well, I guess your application is complete. Now we can entertain a very few questions since we are running quite late. Or comments.
I think maybe the appropriate thing to do is to see it.
Yeah.
And then it's a kind of place that sort of cries out for us to at least give it our best shot on what we think is needed to, when we get this this opportunity to make it be a show place in town. And
right.
So I really,
we could do more discussions.
Yeah, I don't have much to say until we see it and walk around and look at it.
Okay.
Also, Madam Chairman, for future reference, I think it would be tremendously helpful any time that we have received something that is passed on from the zoning board to have the minutes of that subject included in our packet so that we can have the benefit of their discussion. Some of it may be pertinent, and I think we ought to be operating in sync with them as much as possible.
My apologies.
That's a good point. For the next packet, at least, perhaps we could have that. And one other, just a comment on the traffic. I think that corner has been studied, I know, a great deal. There are a lot of problems involved in it. One thing comes to my mind rather recently, and I know there have been some innovative, very innovative ways by the company to allure customers into the building. But also, I think it runs some hazards and dangers. Clowns and so forth are out there beckoning people to come in, and I fear for people stopping suddenly and all of a sudden wanting to come by. And I think that kind of, the nature of that kind of
I think
activity
that's an important
has to be included in any traffic trail.
We do have a letter, which I would like to pass out to the board members, from Bill Bragg, analyzing the site and the impact of this. And I thought if it's appropriate to do that now, I'd be glad to pass that out. And I can call attention very quickly to the key areas of that.
You may pass it out, but I think we're really running behind, and we could discuss it the next time if that's all right with you. Thank you. We'll put it right with all of the... when would you like to go on a sidewalk, board? This coming weekend is Thanksgiving, so I think that's out of the question.
Madam Chairman, we have a site plan, I'm sorry, site walk, at least tentatively set up, maybe more than tentatively set up for Saturday, December 2nd at the Highland site. There's going to be a question in terms of whether we still do that. Uh-huh. It's going to be dependent upon the Normandow study, I would think, partially, but that's up to you.
We didn't announce that tonight, did we?
No. No, we didn't. That was something that was done at the workshop.
Uh-huh. Oh, that's right. It was at the workshop.
But so there's time. I mean, if we are going to have the site walk, mm-hmm. people are going to be out. The question would be how long the Highland site walk is going to take. Like the last one takes up a good chunk of the morning.
Really long. Maybe we could go to the Balfour first and then go on to the Highlands. What time is the Highlands?
Highlands is set right now at 9 o'clock.
9.
Move that to 9:30.
Yeah, and we'll meet. We could meet at 9 at the Balfour property, and the Highlands at 9:30. The later we go, perhaps the warmer it will be. Would that be all right? Would that be all right with you? December 2nd.
Is that okay?
Good.
Madam Chairman, also the Main Street 90 Committee has a town center subcommittee, and representatives of the Planning Board have met with that town center committee, and it might be appropriate to submit this application to them, not for comment necessarily, but for information as they just start designing the town center and thinking about it, that they may want to know about this proposal.
It's a good idea. Fine opportunity. Thank you.
Henry Adams is the chairman of that subcommittee, and if we could send a package to him.
Great. Thank you. Well, we thank you very much for your well-organized presentation.
Thank you. Scott Balfour would like to be briefly recognized, if that would be acceptable.
Sure. Are you Mr. Balfour?
Yes.
Sure. Step right up and welcome Mr. Balfour.
Site plan review. If you go through minor subdivision ordinances and the major subdivision ordinances, very clearly spells out the process of public hearing, site walks, what have you. When you go through the site plan review, that makes no mention of either of those. So I guess I'm wondering what process might I anticipate that's not mentioned in that ordinance?
Well,
like those two things.
We always go on
for site
on
plan
a site walk. That's why maybe that's why it's called a site plan review. No, I'm only kidding. No, we go on site walks on a regular basis for that. Steve, do you have anything to add?
Just to mention that it's something that I did mention to the applicant's representative, so I don't think there's any confusion on that part. But again, I'm available to answer any questions that you may have in terms of the process.
Sort of the same thing if we're going to do that in anticipation of a public hearing and all of that process. I just sort of am looking, since I have no guidance in the ordinance. It just
okay.
says you come before the board.
Well,
and the application doesn't direct you.
Right. Well, Steve will be in touch with you or you with him, and you can get it all straightened out. And we look forward to seeing you all again. Thank you. Have a happy Thanksgiving. Next, is there a representative from Stonegate, Phase 4, an 18-lot subdivision off Mitchell Road and Stonegate Road? The pre-application conference. Good evening. Do you think that Mr. Warren Schenk is going to make it? Possibly. Excuse me, while you're setting up, I'd like to ask the board, we're running a little bit late, about a half an hour, and I just noticed that Mr. Weinschenk came in. Do you think that we're going to make it?
Madam Chairman, I would hope that we could. Scheduled application items, I'd hope that we could continue and not arbitrarily put it off.
Okay. All right. Anyone else?
Well, we have in our rules asked that developers make no longer than a 10 to 15 minute presentation.
Right.
So maybe we can
right.
accomplish this.
Marion, I'm going to abstain from this. My partner, Bruce Cogsall, does some work for.
Right. I remember that.
Mr. Stonegate.
But you're welcome to sit here. You don't have to leave the
room. Well, I notice you have 45 minutes down for this, and I was going to say the same thing as Alan.
Mm-hmm.
Also, during my last conflict, I reviewed the material surrounding the placement of the fill. And what I'd like to do when we're done is take a minute or two, because I think I can save us a half an hour at our next meeting. And I've read this letter, and it seems to be fairly straightforward, and I've got a suggestion.
Super.
I just want to alert you to that.
Super. Great. Thank you.
This is all for one.
What is it
Good evening, Mr. Taylor.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Bob Taylor, and I am a partner in Stonegate Associates, which owns the Stonegate subdivision off of Mitchell Road and the Dyer Pond subdivision off of Shore Road, and approximately 80 acres of land contiguous to those two subdivisions. We are here tonight to discuss on a preliminary basis or sketch plan basis the extension of the Stonegate subdivision, which is located off of Mitchell Road, into this 80-acre parcel that sits between the so-called Dyer Pond and Stonegate subdivisions. Our approach tonight is one of attempting to make the board conversant with the major constraints and opportunities that the site provides, and to discuss a couple of possible development alternatives and to put forward some questions to the board to see if some guidance is available on some issues. I note that earlier on the agenda this evening, there was a presentation that had a lot to do with long dead-end streets, and we have some questions in this area also. The way I would like to proceed this evening is I will have this brief introduction, and then Terry DeWan from Terrence A. DeWan and Associates will present a description of the opportunities and constraints the site offers and raise some of the questions that we feel need to be addressed in the design process. To date, we have made extensive on-the-hoof surveys of this piece of property, as well as the more scientific and technical surveys that are normally required. Our process has been to go out and look at this site and find the best location for houses, and then attempt to find suitable soils in the vicinity of these house sites to provide for subsurface waste disposal, and then to blend those two sets of information with the constraints and other opportunities that the site offers, and come up with a design for the subdivision that provides the most pleasing opportunity to create house sites. In our initial examination, we located 35 spots on this 80 acres that would represent the good house sites. At the time we prepared the sketch plan for discussion tonight, we arbitrarily assumed that we would be able to locate 18 septic systems. In fact, we have been more successful and have located 21. So the final or the preliminary plan that is submitted to you in the future may show more than the 18 lots tonight. But we believe that the sketch plan alternatives that we are presenting tonight are illustrative of the issues that we would like to address. With that, I'd ask Terry to step forward and describe what we have here.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. We will try and keep this brief, knowing that this won't be the first or the last time you'll hear us on the subject. For those of you who have not been out to the site, it's an 80-acre site, and we've put together the plan for Stonegate, of course, which was approved years ago, immediately adjacent to the project which we're calling Stonegate Phase 4, just to show you the relationship between the two parcels of land. In a very preliminary form, we've illustrated some of the major constraints we found on the site. The wetlands are indicated in green on the property right here, and those are made up of a combination of Sebago monkey peat soils as well as other types of wetlands that have been identified by Normando Associates as part of a much larger wetland assessment that they did for us a year ago. We've also indicated the slopes on the property in purple, which represent slopes that are in excess of 25%. There are, of course, a lot of slopes that are in the 15 to 25% range, but we feel that those are workable slopes. The major outline for the property is shown right here. This little piece actually fits up here like a dunce cap. It's sort of an unusually configured property. But it does relate very nicely to Stonegate. Phase 3 of Stonegate is down in this area. This is Greystone Road. This is the loop, the major through road to Stonegate coming out onto the Mitchell Road down here. If you've been out there recently, you know that the construction is now concentrating down at this end of the development, and most of the phase one lots have already been built out of this area. What we've then looked at is a way to incorporate the location for these 20 more or less house sites on the property. If you recall, when we went back on the earlier site walks for Stonegate, there was a lot of site features which we felt we wanted to take advantage of. Here's a neighborhood which seemed to us to be very suitable for a fairly individualized layout. There was a lot of site features, the streams, the knolls, nice trees, wetlands, which needed to be paid attention to. I think we found a lot of the same features here. In fact, we've indicated by the heaving up of the contour line where the knolls are on the site. And you can see that there's probably a dozen different points throughout the property that represent very distinct topographic features in the landscape. And that says to us there's a lot of ways that could be handled. We could take a house and plop it right on top of each one of those sites, which is sort of the typical way of doing it. However, by putting a house here and a house right here and a house right here, you're having houses look directly into each other. The approach that we're trying to pursue here is to use these outcrops and these knolls as barriers or buffer zones between each individual house site. So as you'll see as we go through the two different options, the topography is used as a way to create a sense of privacy and to create a sense of neighborhood in the development. The topography of course also dictates to a large extent where the road can be located. And those are the real big issues that we want to talk about today. As Bob pointed out, there really are two alternatives that we've presented and will be presenting before you tonight for locating the road. This is a result of many iterations of how the road might go through the property.
We're quickly here going through these two different sketches, and the illustrative diagram on the right there is used to understand how some of these work. Bob, can we move over one? See how the topography and the wetlands relate to the site analysis, but you can see on here by the yellow indication where the major wetlands are located. You probably can't see the knolls, but if you look close up, they are scattered throughout the site, and by and large, the houses are located in the valleys between the knolls. This is just a concept plan at this point, and as Bob indicated, we have gone out beyond this stage and located on-site disposal fields. We are in the process of further refining this. Hopefully we'll be coming back before you very soon with a completed preliminary plan. This plan is prepared to try and beg that question of the maximum length of dead-end road. And this plan comes off of what is now known as Greystone Road, which is this road right here, and that would be the major entrance into the site. And the way that we're approaching that particular point of access is calling the first 300 feet a dual access road. It'll be two 18-foot travel ways separated by a 14-foot median that would go the entire length from the intersection of Stonegate Road with the major loop road. The argument being that if there was a major accident, that if there was a tree that fell down, if there was a washout that prohibited access down this major access into the subdivision, there would always be the alternative route in. We have used that approach in other situations. One that comes to mind is the Tamerlane apartment complex in Portland, where we had 115 apartments built in a very long dead-end situation. The fire chief there, after examining the situation, said, well, here's one option we may want to try. And it seems to have worked as far as Portland is concerned. I don't know what the precedent is here in Cape Elizabeth. It's one option that we feel certainly deserves some consideration and discussion tonight. The basic layout looks at three major living areas. You've developed two cul-de-sacs. Each of those has between four and six homes located off of them. And the bulk of the development then is around the loop road. The road winds its way in and out of the the topography. We try and skirt the wetlands as much as possible. We had very little wetland in this approach. The other approach that we're looking at then, we'll put these side by side to compare them, the interior roads and the two figures with the cul-de-sac neighborhoods at the end is identical. The only difference, of course, is the way that we've achieved the two means of access. In this particular concept plan B, we've taken what is now lot 49 from Stonegate, this lot over here, and have reconfigured it somewhat. We've allowed an access way here that would be a 50-foot wide right-of-way that would then provide the continuation of this loop road. So rather than having a double road for the first 300 feet, we now have this plain old loop road that goes for 2,800 feet with two 400-foot cul-de-sacs off of either side. It's interesting to compare both of them side by side. If you consider this section to be one section of road, both of them have 3,700 linear feet of road, more or less. If you were to consider this to be actually two parallel roads, but we've got 300 feet of additional road on the version on the right, concept plan A. Another major difference is that the plan on the left goes over an area of a fairly steep slope. I don't know if you recall from some of the earlier sidewalks out of Stonegate, but the backs of these lots, 48, 47, and 50, drops off fairly rapidly. And it would require going over that slope, a fair amount of filling down the toe of the slope. You would also have to cross a wetland. I don't know exactly how long or how much area would be required, but it would require crossing that the scheme on the right, concept plan A, avoids. There are a lot of other sort of subtle things about what's happening here. Lots 49, 50, and 51 capture a little of the land, a little of the 80 acres that goes with Stonegate Phase 4. So that would be also a modification to the initial Stonegate Phases 1 through 3. At this point, I think there's not an awful lot we'd like to say from a conceptual level. Our promise to keep the discussion to a minimum. I guess I'll turn it back over to Bob, who has some further thoughts on the entrance design, and we have a little model here to talk further about that approach.
Thank you, Terry.
This is not terribly sophisticated, but our thought was that at some point, there can be sufficient separation between two travel lanes to provide sufficient assurance of safety. The judgment issue comes in as to what that separation is. We have drawn a picture of what the road might look like at scale, and we have what we thought would be the most frequent vehicle that would have some potential to slide off the road, just to give you an idea of the scale of things. We chose this particular spacing so that a 40-foot long vehicle, whether that be a major trailer or the largest fire engine in the town or a 32-foot oil truck or something like that, could not block both travel lanes completely. And that's basically where we're coming from there as a rationale for our dimensions. The other issue that I think we ought to mention at this point in time is that in order to achieve the topographic, the clusters answering the topography off of the cul-de-sacs, which we find to be a desirable design feature, we have had to limit the frontage on the road of several of the lots to less than the 200 feet called for in the ordinance for this zone, and believe that the appropriate way to address that is through the public access waiver process and meeting those requirements, but would be delighted to hear the board's, at this time would be delighted to hear the board's reaction to the question of two access roads very close together versus two access roads
substantially separated, and the issue of approaching the design here, utilizing the public access waiver provisions to improve the design.
The public access waiver request would be for the easterly cul-de-sac. And again, we're showing this as a concept plan that's coming for you, the preliminary sketch that may change, but at this point we're really talking in concept. But how you feel about the option of showing an access to a road, to a lot that has less than the 200 feet. It would be physically possible, I suppose, to extend the roadway perhaps another 200 more or less feet just to pick up that 200 feet of legitimate road frontage. It doesn't seem to serve anybody any purpose at this point to do that.
Madam Chairman, just a comment on the public access waiver. I thought there were a provision in ordinance that allowed under subdivision review less frontage than required by normal ordinance standards of the 200 feet. And isn't the public access waiver only when there isn't frontage on a public street?
Public access waiver, as it's written out, can be used for new subdivisions. The only other lessening, I think, is if they were to propose a cluster. I think those are two options, maybe others.
And I believe that there might be some general saving language in either the subdivision or zoning ordinance allowing variances by the board in order to accomplish better design.
I believe that's correct, without a public access waiver. And the way we have used public access waivers in the past has been for lots that have been marooned or landlocked or whatever else and not having direct access to streets. I would think that I would be more comfortable looking at design issues and providing appropriate decisions based on that rather than a public access waiver, if we can.
Yes, I agree.
Second issue is you have a double road, interesting concept, kind of a unique design, but I'm curious why that's being proposed. The maximum length of a cul-de-sac is 500 feet, variable to 1,000 feet under existing ordinances. How long is that piece of road?
I think that begs a good question. In a situation like this, where do you measure 1,000 feet from? Or to start, I would assume at that point right there.
I would assume that to be correct.
You go 300 feet, you measure to the center, and we've got 2,600 feet around the outside.
You measure to the branch point.
We measure to the branch point. So I'm not sure why. I don't think you've exceeded any of the standards.
Our preference, of course, would be to bring a single road in, like our top illustration there, and then to go around the circle in both directions.
Madam Chairman, I want to make sure it's clear. A lot of terms are being used that kind of starts to confuse the issue, I think. If you're talking about a single access road from Stonegate, let's go on alternative A, the point of measurement, the way I understand it, the way I would interpret it at least, would be from Greystone or whatever, Stonegate Road, from from that point back, and looking at Bob's oil truck, and I won't ask if it's a CN Brown or Dead River oil truck, but I think the question is, where could the blockage occur? And from that point, you would measure along the roadway, not the center of the area. So, and from my earlier discussions with the applicant and his landscape architect, that at some point you would have to go over 1,000 feet if you measured it from that point back. So the whole issue is, where could the blockage occur? Measure back from there.
Well, notwithstanding a blockage, we're talking about a dead-end road that cannot exceed 500 feet, cannot exceed 1,000 feet.
Yeah.
And why wouldn't you measure it from the point of intersection with Greystone to the point of tangency where those two roads go off in the loop? From the intersection to where that road loops around. That at that point, it's not a dead-end road when it's looping around, because...
But the issue is that if the blockage occurred way back, it doesn't matter where the loop is, you can't get in. You can't get from 1,000 feet back. So if you're measuring the circle and saying, well, it's not dead-end because it circles around, the blockage occurs before the circle, before the last sewer, whatever you want to call it. I guess I'm not following. Either I'm missing something or... we're not communicating.
That's an interesting concept. We haven't talked about it.
We'll figure that out the next time.
I think that part of your memo that you're going to give us on the other
Madam Chairman?
Yes. Go ahead, Steve.
I have a question on, there are two roads that you've started in already. One at the Greystone location.
This road here is currently under construction.
Right. The next one up, which is?
Granite Ridge Road.
Granite Ridge Road. Okay.
There's no, Granite Ridge Road is separated from this land.
The granite ledge is where the construction is now.
It's proceeding here.
Right.
And here.
Okay. You're proposing that the second access for phase four would go in, which is right, at what point? Which is about at the bottom of the dip in the road,
right here,
as it currently is.
Would be the Plan B entry, and that is lot 49, which we currently own. And what we would propose is to carve 50 feet out of the easterly end of lot 49 to provide roadway right-of-way, and extend lot 49 to make it larger so that we would maintain a buildable lot there.
Just to give Madam Chairman, an opinion, I think I tend to favor the double entry route as you've delineated, being a great lover of wetlands and the preservation of them. I think that, as you've pointed out, that avoids using or crossing wetlands as you would with your two entry over there. But I think I agree with Steve that if you had a blockage further on down before you get to the double entry, I would think you would have to measure your dead-end road from there.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's why we bring the issue, because I don't think it's clear in the ordinance. I don't think there is a method of measurement specified. And different municipalities have approached it different ways with essentially identical language. So the Esplanade approach, the two separate roadways, I think could be an attractive design feature and could really set the entrance apart. I think Terry's right, there's a clear economic preference for the single road. I think that one can make a substantial argument that the risk of blockage is related to the length of road over which single access occurs, in the sense that the oil truck skidding at any point on the road is equally likely, and it might skid, you know, and it has 3/10 as much opportunity to block the road, if you will, in a 300-foot section as it does in a 1,000-foot section. And that might, I think that might address the board's concerns.
Well, I think the next time, we probably would like to learn more about the green belt. We're obviously very concerned about traffic on Mitchell Road. It's at 90% capacity, we have heard. The pedestrian easements. I'd like to know if there is a possibility, if you recall when you came to us with Dyer Pond Road subdivision, the road connecting to Stonegate was an impossibility. It remains an impossibility as a full connector road because the town engineer has indicated that it lacks the width. But it would be nice if we had some sort of a 50-foot right-of-way, you know, from Stonegate to Dyer Pond Road for emergency vehicle use, which we didn't get the last time. That's all I would mention it at this time. Anything else? Well, it looks like an interesting plan with a lot of possibilities, and I guess we'll see you again.
Very good. Are there any other questions or comments?
There is just one. You said that, I think somewhere I read that the site is one-third wetlands. So how many?
Approximately.
So how many acres are left then?
24, 25.
25 acres, and you're proposing 18 lots, and maybe more?
No, you.
First. There's about 25 acres of wetlands.
Oh, I see. I thought that's all that was left on your site. Okay.
There's 55 acres.
Okay. Just for next time, I think it's important that the traffic considerations be looked at, because we've had other developments this evening on Mitchell Road. It's another one on Mitchell Road. And the impact of these additional 18 houses on the traffic, I think, will be important. And you've got a lot of loop-de-loops going through there. I think site distances are going to be a question on some of those roads.
Internally?
Internally.
We have addressed that at least the standards of the ordinance as laid out.
Good.
And wetlands. It's always an issue.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
I'm frankly intrigued by the creativity of that esplanade. I've never thought of it. I congratulate you on thinking it before I did.
You really give the credit to the Portland police chief.
It's amazing where these things. I wanted to ask you how wide the road was from the one side of one road and to the other side of the other, and how big the esplanade is and how big each road
travel curb line to curb line, if you will. We are 50 feet wide, which is two 18-foot travel lanes and a 14-foot wide esplanade.
The middle illustration is a cross-section of what that would look like.
Mm-hmm.
Done to scale, it's 1/4 inch with 1 foot.
And this top illustration is a typical subdivision street of 24-foot travel width.
It has a more rural feel to it with the plantings.
I think that's because we're assuming that, you know, some of the vegetation could be preserved. We wouldn't have to put that 50 feet all the way across.
Mm-hmm.
We won't be reliant upon on-site disposal.
Right.
We won't have to have the, you know, all the excavation required for a sewer line going through there.
It's interesting. It's always a pleasure to see something that's different. Thank you. Well, we thank you, and I guess we'll see you again soon.
Yeah, we hope to submit a preliminary plan application on the 1st of December and to be with you for your December meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You may want to give some consideration to the agenda of that December meeting. We've had a lot of people saying we'll see you in December. Yeah.
And we,
with biggest, two public hearings.
Yeah, one of them will probably be the biggest one.
Everything's always subject to availability of room on the agenda, is I think what you're hearing.
Well, I hate to remind you, but we do have two meetings a month, and we've always said that one meeting doesn't have to be a workshop, could be a regular meeting.
But we have to have a workshop because we have these deadlines. The mobile home park ordinance is enacted on January 1st, and we don't have an ordinance. Then we've got affordable housing. Yeah. We have got to have that workshop. Remember, we were going to cancel it. But now we can't.
Cancel that
idea. Then we had toyed with the idea of canceling the December meeting, but I asked Steve about it, and he said there might be a lot of, there might be problems about that. Well,
and you might be able to do it, then you have to double up somewhere else. And it's like we're talking about doubling up, tripling up.
Because the December meeting is right on top of Christmas and Hanukkah, this particular meeting is on top of Thanksgiving. Needless to say, I won't be baking any pies.
We aren't baking any pies at our house. The power's still out.
Was there a question you had, Mr.
I Taylor? Just wanted to indicate that if the board does have a preference to have us appear at a time different from the regular meeting, we'd be happy to work with them to that end. We don't think we can accelerate our submittal of materials to any earlier than December 1st, though.
Well, another option that I think the board has is to extend a public hearing to two times if we feel the need to do that. We have that right in the ordinance, so.
Or you can simply tell a developer that with a public hearing that's likely to go several hours, they might be wasting their time appearing in December because they probably won't be ready until after 10 o'clock.
But I worry about setting public hearings on December 19th. I want this to be a full public hearing. And it might be good to divide it into two so that people who could not appear December 19th would be before us the next month. I don't know. But we'll have to play that by ear.
Might I suggest that we limit our December appearance to completeness review?
Sometimes takes longer than public hearing.
That could
take whatever you find appropriate.
Months.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for waiting, Mr. Weinchenk. We're sorry that we're running late.
My name is Rick Weinchenk, and I'm here to discuss a two-lot subdivision of slightly over 16 acres located between Route 77 and Ocean House Road.
Can you orient us a little bit better?
I'm sorry?
Can you orient us a little bit better? I found it hard looking at the materials to figure out where it is.
Okay, this is Route 77 going north. And right at this spot is a large rock outcropping that is painted on a regular basis by anybody going by with a can of spray paint.
So you're across the street from the rock?
The rock is on the same side of the street.
Okay, you're up in the woods behind the rock.
In the woods behind the rock.
Okay.
This is Allie Jordan's farm down here. And this is old Ocean House Road. There's a section right in front of this property on Ocean House Road where the road has been reconfigured, been straightened out.
Excuse me, are you abutting Mr. Barton's then property too?
That's the name I don't know.
That's a little to the north. Rick,
okay.
I think this property is somewhere in the vicinity of where the Amaros live. Is that across the, where would the Amaros live?
Here's the farm right here.
Across the street.
Where?
I don't know, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. I think it's in that part of Old Ocean House Road.
That pink line would be roughly next to the road that goes down to the farm off 77?
Yes, it is right there and comes back out at this end about 100 feet down the street. This is land belonging to Richardson and Poole, and I'm not sure exactly how many acres, a large piece undeveloped. There are two houses on Ocean House Road here. This was the Asbury.
Where's the new
place.
Barn that was put in?
The new barn.
South.
That's south here. Of Jordan.
I never go that way. And then there's one other house in the back. Here. Everybody know where we are?
Mm-hmm. I do.
Not quite, but.
Not quite. Anyway, the rest of this, the general topography of the land is relatively flat in old, from Ocean House Road and slowly slopes up till it gets, maybe 20 or 25 feet above Route 77 at that point. And also slopes from south to north to a ridge, a rock ridge that runs right down through the property here. And it's quite steep on the backside, maybe 20 degrees or so. rather shady in the back here as a result of that. And what we would like to do is divide the 16 acres into two parcels, one about 7 acres, one about 9 acres, put one driveway in, have both the houses come off that one driveway. There are good site distance possibilities for at least 3 other locations other than the sharing of the driveway. If the board doesn't like the idea of sharing a driveway, it's a long driveway, and I think having, for example, in this area, 2 parallel driveways would just disturb too much of the, would, for my liking anyway, too much of the land in the front. Coming in from either here or here would mean crossing this ledge ridge, and it would seem to be unnecessarily difficult. And the 2 house sites being on the southern side of this ridge then allows them nice solar and southern exposure and more hardwood trees, thinner trees, and I think also require a little less thinning out just for the house sites. The one house that I have currently designed and have into the building inspector for, and who has rejected my application for a building permit, is about 3,500 square feet, is shingle style, not unlike the houses at Elizabeth Farms. Would have an on-site septic system, which has been designed and located right here, and we would be proposing another septic system in this area, and some that system has not been designed yet, although the test pits have been done and seems to be just fine. Generally on this side of the ridge it's sandy soils with either ledge or old gray, limiting generally 3 to 5 feet down. The most interesting thing, I think, of the whole property is that the Edelweiss Brook is about, at the closest point to this corner, about 150 feet down, and is mapped for resource protection, as it should be. And then in a sort of a slow curve going up through here, and in from the road about 300 feet is mapped Sebago Mucky Peak. When I originally discussed this with the building inspector and asked him for some things I ought to be looking for, he first suggested that I don't pay much attention to the tax map where this thing is already subdivided, that he wasn't sure that was done properly. And in researching that, found that it was in fact never subdivided properly or otherwise, and that we needed to address the Sebago Mucky Peat. So when we did the test pits for the 2 septic systems, I had Ernie come out, look it over, and he said it didn't look like Sebago Mucky Peat to him, but as long as we were there with a soil scientist anyway, would we do some tests and make some more definitive definition of what it was or wasn't. And Mark Hampton from Sebago Technics did the survey for us, and I think you have a letter as part of our package saying not Sebago Mucky Peat. I was hoping Mark would be able to get back out and do a more intense survey of that whole mapped Mucky Peat area so we could find out exactly what it was, whether it was in fact even wetlands or not. It doesn't appear to be, but that's enough for me to say. But we haven't finished that survey yet, so hopefully we will as soon as Mark gets back from his trip. Any questions? Comments?
Madam Chairman, I have a question. How big is this wetland area we're talking about? It's not identified anywhere on the preliminary stuff we have. Is it a huge area, a small area, or?
Scaling it from the wetlands map. It's just somewhat difficult, but anyway, it appears to go the full length of this 246 foot frontage, and then another about 100 feet into the adjacent property, the abutting property.
How deep?
And then from Ocean House Road at its widest point, which is sort of bulb shaped here, is between 225 and 250 feet. It gets down to about 200 feet here, I think. I mean, it could be 10 feet off one way or the other. And that's, as I said, map Sebago Mucky Beach.
What is there at the other access point above? Are there wetlands up there?
It's not mapped that way, no. It doesn't appear to be any different than this. By going out and walking around on it and looking at the vegetation, it looks pretty much the same, as it does pretty much the same all the way back out to Route 77. It's not wet. I mean, it doesn't mean, apparently it's not, doesn't mean it's not wetlands, but it's dry, and it's, the hand augers we did down the road center line were anywhere from 2.5 to 4 feet deep and came up with dry sandy soil.
Are they wetland soils by the new ordinance?
I haven't determined that yet, I'm sorry. But we are going to look into it with the new ordinance in mind.
Where is the area that was of concern for Sebago Mucky Pete?
That's what I'm talking about.
And it's not readily apparent when you walk through it?
It's apparent that it's not Sebago Mucky Pete. It's not apparent that it's wetlands. It's dry to walk through. Hand augers come up with dry, sandy soil.
Well, Sebago Mucky Pete doesn't get dry, I don't think. So
ever.
That's interesting. Madam Chairman, if wetlands will be a big issue, as Mr. Weinschenk knows from previous subdivisions in town. But there are a couple of issues that I think are important. One is that we've got two house lots on how many acres?
16 plus acres.
And we saw 1-2 house lot subdivision on probably less than an acre a little bit earlier in the meeting for a public access waiver. A lot of houses in the next decade will probably be built along Route 77, in some cases off Route 77. We've seen a couple of driveways go off, and I almost think that that's a travesty. When it was originally put in, there were supposed to be no driveways off that new strip, as it was then called, and still, for some reason, is called. And so an access off Ocean House Road, I think, is a preferred access for anything that occurs adjacent to the new strip. And so I think it's appropriate that it come in off Ocean House Road, and we should encourage that if it's going to be developed. Second point is that there is the rock there on apparently your property, or what you have under option for your property.
Yeah.
That is now a community institution, has been for several senior classes over the last several years. And it would be kind of nice to somehow recognize that as an institution in this town by somehow allowing that to occur into the future. And I don't know how you do that other than maybe...
You better check with the police before you start making those comments.
Well,
are you sure that is? Are you sure that is your rock?
I'm pretty sure.
I don't know the extent of right of way on the side of the road. Right of way.
You can have it if it is my rock. Your wish is my command.
That was the last comment.
I had the same concern Dick did, and I guess we'll have to figure out some way to preserve the rock because it's a national landmark now. I also think that looking at...
I'm not sure whether... It very well may be in the right of way.
Getting
100 feet wide there. So.
Getting to something more substantive that we've discussed with you before, that parcel and the fact that it goes from two major roads sort of cries out at one side or another for some sort of a green belt or walkway. It doesn't have to be very big, but... You're asking for something from the town, the public access waiver, I think, because you don't have enough frontage probably for. You don't have enough frontage for the two lots, I assume.
Yeah, there's 101 here, 100 and 146 here, and I don't know, 500 some odd feet
could
on
you
that
really,
side.
Could you realistically access the road 77?
Yeah, this is a good spot right
okay.
there.
All right, well, you're still asking for something. You're asking for approval.
No matter if I'm okay. here, I'm asking for something.
And I just, there's a nice woodsy section by the path to the farm that people walk down, and I think one of the things I'd like you to consider is whether, tucked on one side or the other, you can help our Greenbelt plan for the town.
I'm here to help.
Okay.
As usual.
That's all I have.
Any other questions from yes. Anyone on the planning board?
No? Okay.
Well, if not.
Thank you very much.
It was nice seeing you again.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be here.
Happy holidays.
Same to you, Paul.
Next on the agenda, I would just like to reiterate that on December 5th, we will be having a very important workshop on, I was going to say the wetlands ordinance. I've worked so long on the wetlands ordinance. On the mobile home park law and... and a new ordinance to address that, and we will try to squeeze in affordable housing as well. And anything else?
Yeah, I have two things. I realize it's late. One is I didn't make enough copies, but there was a great article in the Portland paper the other night. Maybe somebody wants to duplicate it. Maybe Steve wants to send it around. Maybe one to Marion. There's a developer in Cumberland who's talking about the need for more country-style roads.
Yeah.
And he points out that most of Maine standards came from New Jersey.
Right.
And I really thought it was great in light of what we're seeing, because I'm just obsessed with the fact that that the people of Cape Elizabeth want to retain the rural character, and we may just have to come in conflict with the people who want every road to be able to make a U-turn for hook and ladder. And I'm not. I think somewhere in the middle lies what we want, and that's an interesting article.
Yes. It's very interesting when you go into some of the older neighborhoods that were established many years ago. Since I'm an older person,
yeah.
You know, I seem to prefer older things, but some of the older neighborhoods have such charm. And
that's right.
The houses are really very close to one another. But the roads are narrow and winding. And
even go up hills, and they're everything that you're not supposed to be now, but they just look better.
Yes, they do.
And they feel better. And so I thought that was an interesting article.
Yeah, well, I thank you for this.
Secondly, since this will probably be the 59th thing on our agenda in December, I've read this little packet. And
what, this?
Yeah.
The letter from...
And basically what it says is... Ms. Tinsman, and is he related to you? They all are, but...
Yes. and recognizing that I won't participate
in this. Okay, well, I think I'll just take 1 minute and tell you that basically Mr. Tinsman had 5,000 square feet that less than 5,000 square feet of wetland. He put sand in to build this small house on the corner.
Mm-hmm.
He's marked it all off according to this thing. The bulldozer man then proceeded to bulldoze
right,
an extra 1,500 square feet.
It's indicated in this letter.
He went to Ernie McVane, and Ernie said, you get two choices, either get a wetlands alteration permit or remove it, but you need the planning board's approval to remove it, and until you do remove it, then you can't occupy your house.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to me that, consistent with everything that we have said in the past, we are skeptical about people who want to fill in the first place. We've been reluctant to entertain people who want to have us after the fact if he fills. I think we're only going to come out one place, that he ought to remove it, and we ought to establish a precedent that if somebody fills a wetland accidentally, they ought to remove it. And it's easy in this case because the guy wants to remove it.
I think that's what I said.
Actually, I think there is a precedent for this. It wasn't a filled situation, but it was a disturbance of Sebago monkey people.
For removing.
Mm-hmm.
They removed something.
Yes, they did.
I think we made them restore it, didn't we, Steve?
That was before my time, I'm not sure.
That's right, we did. You're right.
And so there is a precedence for this, somebody fessing up and for us saying, okay, restore it. So we do have a precedence.
That's where we're going to come out anyway, and the guy makes the point that if we wait more than 2 weeks, it's going to freeze, and he's not going to be able to do it, and we're not going to get it removed promptly. And then he talks about the new ordinance maybe wouldn't define this as wetlands, and I'm not sure that if we get the option to tell them to remove it, I'd like to tell them to remove it now, and I think everybody comes out of it happy. And if I'm missing something, Steve...
Are you suggesting that perhaps we can avoid his appearance before the planning board?
Yeah.
By making a motion,
he's written us a letter. And I think we ought to order him to remove it subject to the approval of the code enforcement officer
has some sort of authority over it.
Sounds good, but I don't think even if you wanted to, you could do it under the current standards. Secondly, I guess the point that hits me is that it's been filled. There has been after-the-fact alteration. There's no question about that, inadvertent or not. But the question in terms of just having him remove it is that to remove it might be even more harmful to what's there than leaving it. And I think that before anybody says anything one way or another, I think what Greg Tinsman has to do is kind of state what he wants to do, how he's going to, in essence, allow things to revert back as much as he can to the way they were, if that's what he wants to do, and do it in a kind of a thoughtful sort of way versus having somebody come in, scoop it out, or get a bulldozer in. And so I think for practical purposes as well as procedural purposes, procedurally, I don't think the board could say, just do it and it's kind of a done deed.
But he could do it himself anyway. I mean, he could go there tomorrow and take away what he put there.
Not really.
Sure he could.
It's in a map wetland. He would be by, you can't necessarily.
Steve, I'm telling you, if this guy went out there tomorrow and removed it, what would be the violation? If he violated it in the first place by putting it there, are we saying it's a second violation by taking it away?
I suppose, yes.
It's
similar to the Davis issue where, there's a question about filling that happened 10 years ago, and some people on the board said, look, it was filled. And it was filled back then, and it's an issue. I mean, I think the item's been filled, and I think you set a dangerous precedent if you say, well, as long as you kind of unfill it, you're okay.
Well, no, I'm
well,
not saying
I,
that.
I think, Dan, perhaps there's another point here, too. I think that people have noticed this being built in amongst cat and nine tails and alders and obviously a wetland area. So that it might be better to have a public minute recording this action. So I think I would agree with Steve's point that we perhaps should go through the process.
Well, I guess the process is fine, but I think the thing that I would be concerned about is when we lose the opportunity to tell this person to remove it, because I think it's an important precedent, as Ivan points out, and I think it's one we want to be consistent on.
But I'll add, Dan, that went through process. I mean, when we told Purputa to undo it, it was through process.
Well, how do we do it fairly quickly? I guess that's the question. I mean, if this guy comes back to us with a reclamation plan that he's discussed with our code enforcement officer, who says, in my opinion, it's back the way it was, because I don't think for 1,500 feet in that area we can spread this out over 3 months and run the risk that we have an unoccupied house with I just picture this thing with the car paper fluttering all around.
Well, I think you're picturing the wrong place, then. This is not the real estate place.
The what?
This is not the real estate place.
No, I know this. No, this is up in the corner there on the.
Okay, I thought you might be thinking it was
the corner of Ocean House Road and 77.
Since some of you have a problem with the procedure, etc., I noticed here that it had to be done, that he couldn't come before us until February.
That's what he says, is he couldn't get approval.
Couldn't we?
You could shorten the process so that to a certain point, naturally, then if you wanted to push it, we could explore further. How the process would work normally, in a shortened way, is that if he came in December, you'd be at your December meeting. If the materials were all there, the application was complete, you would then set a public hearing, which under the ordinance is required. Maybe you could waive it. Then at the January meeting, you could hold a public hearing, and if everything was fine, you could grant approval that evening. I mean, when we talked this morning, he said, how could the process go? And I described it. Well, it could go that, the board doesn't have to make a decision in January. So, I mean, instead of February, you could be making a decision in January. Question to the applicant is that soon enough? He's probably going to say it's not.
I don't agree that we need a wetlands alteration hearing for him to remove something that he put in. Now, there may be a violation there, and there may be an enforcement situation. I'm not disputing that, but he can go there tomorrow. The judge would laugh at us, Steve, if we said you can't undo what you did. Now, maybe you do it at your own risk if you don't do it well.
I guess it's like the Balfour situation. I mean, anybody can do anything they want, but at what point does the town step in?
Balfour wanted to leave it there.
Not allowed. But I guess the issue is if he didn't want, if he wanted to take it out and keep it going, shouldn't the town allow
it? I just said the same thing to him. I said, we can't stop you from taking it out. You may have a violation for having put it in the first place. But
I guess I would disagree with that.
Talked to Tom Leahy about this.
I haven't. I didn't know that this letter was going to be coming
I think that as soon as you possibly could, I would talk to Tom Leahy about this and have him address this matter, because from my point of view, as soon as the wetland is fixed and restored to being a wetland again, to absorb water and not jeopardize adjacent properties, I'm all for that. I don't care what the process is. I don't know how the rest of you feel, but I think that that is very important.
The question maybe ought to be the quickest way possible.
Sure.
That's right.
Within our procedures.
And then our procedures would be legal, and we would be doing our share to get the wetland restored.
Yep.
Excellent. I will give that. Thank you, Steve. Anything else? Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second. Happy Thanksgiving to everyone.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Oh. We're all going to have to depend on the bakery, aren't we?